Very warm greeting to you all in the name of the Lord on this lovely day. It seems to me it's an early spring delight. And please listen carefully to the following few announcements. The first is, I think it's very much in order to thank everyone who helped yesterday with all the arrangements for the funeral. I just think everything went exceedingly well from that point of view, though we had no water. There was no problem. Rob and I went and bought half the Firth of Forth, and we were amply supplied. And one just rejoices in the beauty of God's creation and all His goodness to us, simply in the flowers that Jen did. And Helen was here arranging for the food to be beautifully laid out, and just so many folk were involved. I hope, by God's grace, you enjoyed serving Him. And then also for our encouragement, our sister Marley got a phone call. She was looking after good neighbours. About midday, was it? People saying, we've come all the way from Cape Town. We're not going to make it by closing time. So she stayed open. And she told me these charismatic folk bought every book she told them to buy. They left the bookshop 6,000 rand lighter in their credit card facility. But still, may I just say that we must not grow weary of doing good and serving the Lord, and the Lord is our joy. And we must give thanks to Him for all He has enabled us to do. Do we not pray every time we sing that beautiful psalm, Moses' song, Psalm 90, that the Lord will establish the work of our hands? And that's what it's about. And then please take notice that we meet next Saturday morning, those of us who want to come to the Covenant Bible Study and play games. We're going to be playing mini golf next Saturday, so if you have any old golf sticks you'd like to bring with you, please do that. Golf is for everybody under the age of 106. And then we will have some lunch, and then we'll come and meet here in the church for our Covenant Bible study. And that will be streamed on YouTube and on free conference call. Then please pray earnestly for the work of the college. We resume our studies the first week of September. And our Lord Jesus said to His disciples, the fields are white unto harvest. Well, we feel very much like that about the situation in our country. So please be earnestly in prayer for us and for Ty and Clinton as they resume their studies. We want to make the excellencies of Christ our Savior known. Well, let's take just a couple of moments and prepare our hearts to meet with God. Our attitude ought to be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Well, let us do just that As we take up our hymn books, please turn to hymn number 176. We are going to confess the glory and the lordship and the wonder of our Savior in Him. Hymn number 176. Pray for all the churches that belong to our Savior and Lord. Please bless your people who gather in his name. Please stir us up and revive us, and grant that we will worship you with deepest, tenderest fears, that we will exalt in you with joy unspeakable and full of glory, that more than anything we will know you and make you known. Bless us, O our God, we pray. For we ask these mercies confidently and gladly, in the name of Christ our Saviour. Amen. Amen. Would you please turn now in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We continue our consecutive reading in God's Word. Let us give careful attention to the Word of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Are you not the result of my work in the Lord? Even though I may not be an apostle to others, surely I am to you. For you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. This is my defense to those who sit in judgment on me. Don't we have the right to food and drink? Don't we have the right to take a believing wife along with us, as do the other apostles and the Lord's brothers and Cephas? Or is it only I and Barnabas who must work for a living? Who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its grapes? Who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk? Do I say this merely from a human point of view? Doesn't the law say the same thing? For it is written in the law of Moses, "Do not muzzle an ox while it is treading out the grain." Is it about oxen that God is concerned? Surely he says this for us, doesn't he? Yes, this was written for us, because when the plowman plows and the thresher threshes, they ought to do so in the hope of sharing in the harvest. If we have sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much if we reap a material harvest from you? If others have this right of support from you, shouldn't we have it all the more? But we did not use this right. On the contrary, we put up with anything rather than hinder the gospel of Christ. Do you not know that those who work in the temple get their food from the temple? And those who serve at the altar share in what is offered on the altar. In the same way, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should receive their living from preaching the gospel. But I have not used any of these rites. And I am not writing this in the hope that you will do such things for me. I would rather die than have anyone deprive me of this boast. Yet, when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast. For I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have a reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge, and so do not make use of my rights in preaching it. Though I am free and belong to no man, I make myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave, so that after having preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. Will you now please take up your hymn books and sing to the praise of our Saviour, hymn number 61, a hymn that flows out of the very scripture we have read, Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of My Heart, hymn 61.
Oh,
throne of God's grace. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we pray earnestly that you will continue the good work that you began in us in this little congregation and in our dear brethren at Grace Covenant Reformed Church in Cosmos City. We pray, Lord, that your mercies will abound to us, your unfailing compassions will be our portion, that we may be your servants and we may serve you well, that through us and in the works you've given us to do, your kingdom may come and your will may be done, and people may honor you and serve you and love you to their dying breath. Thank you again for the example of our pastor departed just a week ago. And we ask, Lord, for grace to follow him as he followed you. We know that no man is perfect, but Lord, we know that by your grace there was no compromise. He was determined to honor you. And it is our earnest request, Lord, that you will work in us by your Spirit so that we may have that determination. And we ask in particular that none of us will fall short by unbelief, by laziness, by giving up, by folly, by self-indulgence, by pride, all these many pitfalls. Please, O Lord, as you have graciously dealt with us, continue with us. And so we ask that you will provide for us what we need from day to day. We ask that you will watch over us in our jobs, in our homes, in our families, in our health. We ask for grace for those who struggle in all these areas, and we have many who are chronically ill. We ask for grace to look to you, to trust in you. And we ask, Lord, that you will help us not to put our confidence, as we heard in our study this morning, in princes, even the best of men or physicians. But our hope is in the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And we ask, Lord, for the forgiveness of our sins. They are many, and we confess with your servant in the Psalms, if you were to keep a record of sins, oh Lord, who could stand? We are so miserable. We are so selfish and prideful. We find that we have malice, we have selfishness, we have lies springing to our lips. We have violence flooding our hearts. And we confess with Paul, the good that we would, we find ourselves not doing. And the evil we would not, we do. What stupid, wretched people we are. And our sins are not just against you and your majesty, but against you and your love for us in Christ. Your grace upon grace. Oh Lord, forgive us, we pray. And thank you for your promise that there is forgiveness with you. For our sins were borne by our Savior in his body on that tree. There is forgiveness with you, and therefore you are feared. And we ask again for grace to walk in your way everlasting. And we ask, O Lord, that none of us will be deceived by sin's deceitfulness and hardening, and go the way of the world and the devil. O Lord, we also pray that you will keep us faithful to you, and all the churches of Jesus Christ. We remember particularly our dear brethren in Cosmo and in the churches in Natal that we have come to know and love so well, in our little network of reforming churches, and in the Vergadering of Kerke, Reformierte Kerke, that we belong to, and beyond that through our contacts in the good neighbors and in the college. These many brethren and churches with whom we have fellowship, keep us from temptation, deliver us from evil that lurks all around in the world and from the enemy of our souls and in our own breasts. Lead us in your everlasting way. And please grant, O Lord, that the truth may prevail in our day. We live in a time where everybody just believes what they want to believe in defiance of you, and that in the churches. And we ask that you will have mercy. And in your wrath, remember, O Lord, your determination to save your people, to have your glory cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. So please may there be light and life to the honor of our Savior, to the glory of your name. Please revive us, O God, so that we may count for you in a way beyond our ability to think or imagine, and we may see you loved and known and feared. Please bless us now as we come to consider your word. Please, O Lord, may your word deal with us, with the grieving, with the depressed and lost and needy, with our visitors whom you are glad to have with us this morning according to their need. But Lord, may your word prevail in our hearts, and may we go from our worship of you this morning glad that you have met with us, glad that your work has rebuked and corrected and trained us in righteousness and filled us with holy zeal to be your servants. And all these mercies we ask in Jesus' holy, precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Kingdoms and thrones to God belong. That's the glad confession of our song and the words of hymn number 81. Crown him, the nations, in your song. Let us sing the praises of our God. Hymn number 81. So when Jesus appeared to him and warned him to stop sinning because he was a self-indulgent, self-preoccupied, thankless sinner. To stop sinning or God might judge him and something worse might come upon him. He then pointed out Jesus to these Jews. As a result, we see what happened from verse 16. So, because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him and... So, because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him. Jesus said to them, "My Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. For this reason, the Jews tried all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." Jesus gave them this answer: "I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, to your amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so even the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. By myself, I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just, for I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. If I testify about myself, my testimony is not valid. There is another who testifies in my favor, and I know that his testimony about me is valid. You have sent to John, and he has testified to the truth. Not that I accept human testimony, but I mention it that you may be saved. John was a lamp that burned and gave light, and you chose for a time to enjoy that light. I have testimony weightier than that of John. For the very work that the Father has given me to finish, and which I am doing, testifies that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me has himself testified concerning me. You have never heard his voice, nor seen his form, nor does his word dwell in you, for you do not believe the one he sent. You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me. Yet you refuse to come to me to have life. I do not accept praises from men, but I know you. I know that you do not have the love of God in your hearts. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not accept me. But if someone else comes in his own name, you will accept him. How can you believe if you accept praise from one another, yet make no effort to obtain the praise that comes from the only God? But do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. Your accuser is Moses, on whom your hopes are set. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say? These Jews were intent on killing the Lord Jesus. And the Jews identified here in this particular passage of Scripture are the Jews who lived in Judea. The actual Greek word is Judeans. We get the word Jew, it's an abbreviation of Judean in the English language. And they were zealous for Jerusalem and the temple and everything that had gone around that. And these Jews did not regard Galileans as Judeans, as Jews. They regarded them as Galileans. And you see that in the scripture. Now, in our day, we call all people who are Jews, Jews. We don't make those kind of geographical distinctions. But these are a group of Israelites who lived in and around Jerusalem in Judea and had very insistent ideas on what it meant to be God's people. And so when this man who'd been healed was carrying his mattress, they stopped him immediately and told him he was breaking the Sabbath. Of course he was not. And then they wanted to know who had healed him, because he in turn had blamed Jesus for his breaking the Sabbath, right? And when they confront Jesus, it's not in order to inquire what the truth of God is. It's to persecute him. Because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, we read in verse 16, the Jews persecuted him. And what's our Savior's response? It's very important because it's instructive. Are we not called to follow his example? Are we not called to live a life of love just as Jesus loved us? Read that in Ephesians 5 verse 1. Doesn't he love these Jews? Of course he does. And so he testifies to the truth of God. And what is his response? It's most astonishing. Jesus said to them, verse 17, my Father is always at his work. To this very day. And I too am working. And just briefly last week we mentioned that what he's referring to here is the teaching that was abroad at the time. That God himself, when he created the world, on the seventh day he ceased from his work of creating. Alright? He didn't make any more trees, so to speak, as he did on the fifth day, or any more animals, and so on. He rested. But he couldn't cease being God. And God is always at work upholding the world and the vast universe and dealing, as the rabbis of the time taught, with the wicked and the righteous. So it was accepted that God himself, on his seventh day, had stopped working. He had entered into a Sabbath rest from the work of creation, but not from his being God. Because if God ceased to uphold things and to sustain things and to work in his universe, it would cease to exist. Alright? And the Lord Jesus says to them, "Well, my Father's been working to this very day, and I too am working." And that confronts them with two truths they did not want to believe. And so we read in verse 18, "For this reason the Jews tried all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." They understood it very clearly. And they didn't like it. And they didn't accept it. And their response was murderous. And so from this point on, these influential Jews, and they were influential. We read in John's Gospel that people did various things, but for fear of the Jews, they didn't do them publicly. They were wary of this Jewish party. And when Jesus drove the traders and all the merchandisers out of the temple in John chapter 2, it was the Jews who asked him, "Huh? By what authority are you doing this? Who said you could do this? Who do you think you are?" Well, we're going to meet them again and again, so I don't want to spend too much time. But they have decided, right there, as they see this man who is healed, that the healer is to be opposed because he's breaking their notions of the Sabbath. And in response to that, Jesus says, "I'm not breaking the Sabbath. I'm doing the work of God. My Father is working, and I am working." And they rightly conclude, he has put himself, in his simple explanation as to why he healed this man, he is saying, "I am doing the work of God on the Sabbath day." And their response is, in effect, "What? You're making yourself equal with God." Now for us, and that's what this morning's sermon is going to be about, that raises some very important considerations and questions, I hope, in your own mind. And it raises, of course, what the theologians like to call Christology. And that's a beautiful word. It simply means the study of Christ. Just like zoology, coming from the Greek word for life and for study, or reasonable discourse, is the study of living animals. So Christology is the study of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did in order to save us and to bring glory to his Father. And the first thing I want to say that's very important to you is that most people find Christology very difficult. But it's not. Even the youngest child here can understand the essence of Christology. And so that begs a question from us, doesn't it? Why is it so difficult? Why is it so difficult to understand Scripture's teaching, our Savior's own teaching about himself, recorded for us here in John's Gospel? And the answer is that most people, just like the Jews here, don't want to believe what is taught. We'd rather have our own ideas about that believe the living and true God who reveals himself to us in his word. I was talking to a man yesterday and it was very obvious. Says he's become a Christian, but he wants to think his own thoughts about God and the world in which we live. He's no Christian at all. But you see, this is our nature. This is what we are. Don't you find this in your own heart? You don't want to believe what the scripture teaches. It's much easier in your pride and much more self-pleasing to form your own notions. Who is anybody to tell you what you should think? Do it for yourself. There was a country song when I was a kid. They've got a lovely line in it, right? I'm all right now, I've learnt my lesson well. Can't please everybody. So, you've got to please yourself. Maybe that tune will be one of those tunes that worms its way in your head for the rest of the day. I don't know if you have that melody, but that sometimes happens to me. I get these songs that wind through my head and I can't get them out. Well, if that does, I hope it will remind you that this is what we are. And we think this is okay. You can't please everybody, so please yourself in what you believe, in what you think, in what you want to understand. Form your own ideas. And the self-pleasing is a horrible, horrible, horrible idolatry. And what the scripture calls us to do, every single one of us, is to believe what God says. And that's what the Lord Jesus is saying in this passage. And I wish there were time for us to take a whole conference on this chapter of God's word and to unpack all the details. But if you believe what God tells you in his word, and as he says at the end of this chapter to the Jews, if you believed Moses, you say you believe Moses, well, if you believed him, you would believe me, because Moses tells you all about me. But they didn't want to. And so he says, instead, you don't want to come to me. You refuse to come to me that you might have life. It's tragic, but here we see a very graphic portrayal of what we are by nature. Believing what we want to believe because we want to please ourselves. We have our Savior patiently, gently, compassionately, and beautifully telling us who he is. And that's very important. So I would like this morning just to give careful attention to verse 23 and to make just a couple of foundational points. Christological points, truths about the Lord Jesus that you must take to your heart. You must understand them in your mind, you must take them to your heart, and you must make them foundations for your Christian life. So please give careful attention to verse 23. The Lord Jesus is explaining that he is doing the work of God so that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. And he explains, he who does not honor the Son, that's himself, the Lord Jesus, does not honor the Father who sent him. So we're going to look at him as he testifies about himself here as a result of the miracle he has performed and his interaction with this poor, stupid man who is thankless and foolish and wrapped up in himself. We see the Lord's testimony, and we see that number one, in his testimony about himself, he is saying that he is God. Jesus, born of Mary, laid in the manger in Bethlehem's stable, has always been and forever will be God, even as God the Father is God and God the Holy Spirit is God. That's our first point. Our second point is that he is sent by God. He is God. He is sent by God. And so then thirdly, as he is sent by God, he is God's Son, the Messiah, for our sake. Now that's quite a lot to take in. May I encourage you to believe God's word, and you will find that it's beautiful, it sits beautifully in your mind and so in your heart. Well, Jesus is God. How do we see that in verse 23? It's in the first part of that verse, right? That all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Now, as God reveals himself to us in his beautiful life-giving word from the beginning, he tells us many things about himself. And long before the Lord, the living and true God, revealed himself in explicit terms as three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, he wrote and recorded and told his people that he is the one, only, living, true God. We are monotheists. We worship the only God who exists. Now, there are many people who have one God, but they don't believe that he is the only God. They just worship one God among many. Those people are not monotheists. They are technically henotheists. Monos in Greek means only. You worship the only living and true God. Heno comes from the Greek word henos, which means one. You just worship one God. So there are people, for example, in Chatsworth or Phoenix, Hindu people, who will put a flag down the bottom of their driveway. And having spent many days staying with friends there, you can see how some people have one flag, some people have several flags. These flags identify which deity is worshipped in that home. So people who have one flag and worship one deity are henotheists. That's very, very different from what it means to be a monotheist. And the Lord said through Moses to his people, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God, all your heart, and all your soul, and all your mind, and all your strength." Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4, 5, and 6. And that is absolutely foundational. And if we don't understand that, we are going to run into trouble in our understanding of this phrase. So that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father who sent him. What the Lord Jesus is saying is that the honor and the worship and the praise and the service and the adoration that belongs to the Father belongs to me in the same way. And I've come so that as a result of everything I am doing and am going to do, that same divine worship and honor will come to me. Now, he is not saying that there are two gods, the Father and the Son. He is saying that as the Son, he is as divine as the Father is. You see, God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he's not a mixture of three persons in one God. He is one God who always existed as three persons. And these persons are not confused. They're not merged, they're not mingled. Very clearly, God has revealed himself to us in that way. So that when the Lord Jesus instructed his disciples to baptize those who would come to believe in him, he said, you're to baptize them in the name Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Now, of course, we don't comprehend that. But when we believe God's word, we know it is true. God in his being is wonderful. He is not like us. He is the creator. We are the creatures. And he has revealed himself to us as much as we can know of him. And we will spend all eternity growing in our knowledge and appreciation of him, his being, and his ways. We are made in his image, but we are not of the substance of God. We're not emanations of God. We are distinct creatures. And the whole creation is not part of God. God, without losing anything of his own infinite energy and power, created the universe by his word for his glory. And everything that exists, exists in dependence upon him. And we read in the script, if you read it carefully, that the glory of all creation belongs ultimately to the Father, who we may think of as the architect of all creation. Those living creatures in heaven falling down before the throne and worshipping him. For he created all things, and all things have their being by his power. And so they worship and honor him. But he made all things through his Son. So that we read in John chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and all things were made through him. And without him, nothing was made that has been made. And we read of the Spirit. In Psalm 33, that his work is to renew the creation because he is the creator. And it seems to me that if the Father is the architect of all creation, the Son is the contractor who goes to the building site, as it were, and brings it about through the Spirit, who is the bricklayer, in effect, who knits us together. All God's works are the work of his Trinitarian being in a beautifully ordered way. God is God. And so it is when it comes to our salvation. God the Father is the author, the elector. God the Son comes to save us. God the Spirit applies these things by working in our hearts. All glory be to God. So the Lord Jesus simply says to these who said, I'm going to kill you because you've made yourself equal to God. He simply says, I am equal to God because I am God. The Son has come and he's doing this work so that in verse 23, can you see this? All may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. And unless he is truly the one living God, as much as the Father and the Spirit are the one living God, though distinct in their personal identities, unless this is true, what he is saying is idolatrous and horrible and blasphemous. But it's not. Little children, this is the truth of God. You have been formed and brought into your family by this God who loves you. This God who is Father, Son, and Spirit. And so the first thing about Christology that we've learned this morning is Jesus Christ is God. Second, he's been sent by God. See that at the end of our verse? We are to honor the Father, to honor the Son, just as we honor the Father, and if we do not honor the Son, if we do not worship the Lord Jesus as God, we do not honor the Father who sent him. Oh, this is wonderful. You see, God in his one being is three persons, and the Father, who is not the Son nor the Spirit, may send the Son, who is not the Father nor the Spirit, into the world. And later in John 15 and 16, we read how the Father is going to send the Spirit, and the Son is going to send the Spirit. The Trinitarian doctrine is not something we devised and invented for ourselves. We believe it because it's revealed in the Scripture, and it's beautiful. And it's life-giving, divine truth. So, Jesus talking to those Jews in Jerusalem is God, and he was sent by God into our world. Why? To rescue us, of course. To bring life and light and healing to our death and darkness and the decay of all our moral diseased souls. It's wonderful. And so he sent him to do his work. Just as in creation, the Father created the universe through the Son, so in salvation, the Father is the Savior through the Son, who was given the name. Remember what the angel said to Joseph? When Joseph, because he was a righteous man, wanted to quietly put Mary away, the angel came and said, don't do it. The Son is going to be born to him, and he's been conceived by the Spirit in Mary, and you're to give him the name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. But aren't Christians God's people? Don't we call upon the name of the Father? Don't we belong to the Father? Yes. And so we belong to the Son, because the Son who was sent by the Father is as divine as the Father is. But he comes into this world not to do his own purposes, but to do the will of the Father who sent him. Do you understand that? Is that clear? I hope so, because it's so beautiful, and I don't want to get in the way of God's truth here by confusing you. Jesus is God. Jesus was sent by God. And one little extra word here, which I think is very important. In the history of the churches, these truths have been preached and defended and taught. We have seen that all this truth rests on the fact that God in himself, when he decreed to make this universe and this beautiful blue planet in this tiny little solar system, in this small constellation of stars at one end of the universe, when he decreed to do that, he had also decreed to work on his purposes so that the Father would elect a people from this little blue planet for himself. The Son would rescue them, and the Spirit would bring life into them so that they would trust God, believe the Son, call God their Father, enabled by the Spirit. And that's called, the Latin term is Pactum Salutis, Council of Peace. So that God the Father is the chief architect of your salvation. God the Son undertook to become the one who saves you by his blood. And God the Spirit undertook to be sent by the Father through the Son to work these things in us. It's an eternal counsel of God, and it's beautiful. So, number one, Jesus is God. Number two, he is sent by God. Number three, he is sent by God as the man, our Messiah. And that's obvious, because he's the man, Jesus, standing in front of these Jews, saying to them, all are to honor the Son just as they honor the Father. And he who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Who's speaking those words? The man standing in Jerusalem, speaking to these Jews. So that the Lord Jesus, even as he is God, God of God, the creeds and confessions tell us, very God of very God, begotten, not made, before all ages, of one substance with the Father. Oh, brothers and sisters, he is as human as you and I are at the same time. That's a wonderful mystery. It's as wonderful as the mystery of the being of God himself, who is a Trinitarian God. So that as a man, he bears the title Son of God in two senses. He bears the title Son of God as God, the eternal God, because even though he was a man, he did not cease to be God, and so to deserve the honor that belongs to God alone, just as the Father is honored, the Son is to be honored. And yet, when he became a man and took to himself a true human nature, a real body, just like you and I have, and a true, reasonable human soul, just like you and I have. He didn't cease to be God, but as he walked the streets of Galilee and Samaria and Judea and Jerusalem, you didn't see that he was God. You saw a man standing in front of you, who is the Son of God because he is the second person of the Trinity, and is the Son of God because he is the Messiah, the sent one. And that title, Son of God, is very precious. We read that in Psalm 2. Kiss the Son. Who is the Son? Well, the New Testament tells us. The Lord Jesus is God's Messianic Son. And the promise in 2 Samuel 7, God speaking to David, telling him he will have a son. God will own this king as a son, and his kingdom will never end. Who is the son? It's not Solomon. We go on and read through Samuel into Kings. It's all one book. It's just divided up into different scrolls. That's why we English Bible have different names, but in the Hebrew Bible it's one big book. Solomon is such an appalling failure. But God's promises don't fail. They are all yes and amen in Jesus Christ. And so he is God's Son by virtue of being the second person of the Trinity, the Son of the Father. And he is God's Son because he has come as the sent one. And in his person as the Messiah, possessing two natures, a divine nature and a human nature, he is God's Son. Come to rescue us. And so, it's really beautiful, this Christology. And it's worth thinking about, and it is worth meditating on. Well, what difference does that make to you as you sit here this morning? I hope, number one, this thrills your heart to think that God has stooped to deal with you. That when it comes to your being rescued from your sins and your selfishness and your own perversities and the stinking corruption of your rebellion against God, God came into this world to do it. God the Father, in his love for you, sent no less a person than his own Son. And no other one could have effected this great work of God. Do we not read in the Bible, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting our sins against us. It's a wonderful thing. The dimensions of what God has done to save you just are beyond your ability to fully grasp, and yet they flood you with this deep light and joy and peace. And you glory in your God, and you honor the Son as you honor the Father, and you honor the Spirit as you honor the Father and the Son. I hope this makes all the difference in the world, Jim, because if it doesn't, I worry that you are still lost and in your sins and you do not know God. You are without God and without hope. What God did in his love for you is more than you can begin to describe, and yet it's true, it's true, it's true. That's the first thing. But then the second important response is, but why don't people believe this? And why is this hardly believed in the church today? There is hardly a New Testament scholar who's of a reputation as able to work in the Greek and the Hebrew and the Aramaic and all these technical things and has a professorship at a university and writes books. There's hardly a New Testament scholar who really believes these truths. Why? Aren't they plain? Aren't they evident? Isn't this the teaching of the scripture? And the answer is, as we went back to where we started from, because we do not want to believe the truth of God. Because if we do, we will have to honor the Lord Jesus, and we will have to live and die for him. It's a very personal thing what we believe about God. What do you really believe? You should perhaps one day have a look at the Shorter Catechism, and then write your own Shorter Catechism. What do you think you are here for? Who do you think made you? Who do you think you essentially are in your being? What are you? Why do you do the things you do and think the things you think and say the things you say? And what is your life all about? And what's going to happen when you die? And who is God outside of yourself? Write down the catechism of what you really believe. And you'll find that it's natural to us to want to please ourselves. And there's no limit to that. And so these Jews searched the scriptures, but they couldn't see the Lord Jesus. And these scholars today, they search the scriptures, and they can't see the God's own truth. They don't want to see themselves as sinners in desperate need of God coming to rescue them. God the Father sending his Son to possess them and have them and own them and to die on the cross as a man to bear their sins in that horrific, horrific judgment as he entered into hell on the cross. The judgment of God upon us and our sins. This is too humiliating to us in our pride. That's why it's not believed. And I warn you, if you choose to believe what you want to believe, God will lead you to believe your own lies in hell forever when you die. And then finally, for your encouragement and for your enjoyment and for your joy, where are we taught these things? These Christological, theological, beautifully complex, but radiantly clear truths. And where do we confess them? Didn't we read in our call to worship, every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father? How do we do that? Some churches want you to recite the creed. We don't. We believe everything taught in the creed and a great deal more. But we sing, as we sang this morning, in our opening hymn, O Jesus, King most wonderful. We own him as our God. Without being idolaters, without worshipping three gods, but we bring glory to God the Father in our deep appreciation and worship of God the Son. Jesus, your mercies are untold through each returning day. Your love exceeds a thousandfold whatever we can say. What are we saying? The Lord Jesus is my shepherd. I shall not want. May every heart confess your name and ever you adore. You see, that's the right response. And we sing the praises of him who died, of him who died upon the cross. We sing the glories of the Father. We sing the sublime, beautiful work of the Holy Spirit. And we confess these things from our hearts. At least I hope we do. Because if you don't sing these things from your hearts, again, the question is, do you know God? Do you know God? I was just about to turn to hymn number 3 and have you look at that, but it's missing in this particular edition. Now thank we, O our God, the one living and true God with hearts and hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom our heart rejoices. All praise and thanks to God, the Father now we give. The Son, who's that? The Lord Jesus. And him who reigns, who's that? The Holy Spirit, with them in highest heaven. The one eternal God, whom heaven and earth adore, for thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore. When you sing, you're to confess these truths. And if you sing and you're not confessing these truths, you're in deep trouble. And you need to go to God. And if you go to him sincerely, in all your need, he will rescue you. And he will forgive you. And you will be able to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Life is short. It's not to be lived without knowing God. We are to honor the Son just as we honor the Father. And if we do not honor the Son, we do not honor the Father who sent him. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, truths of your word, the truths which you sent your Son, our Saviour, to proclaim to us, are more than we are able with our feeble, weakened, sin-filled natures and minds to grasp. But you promise that your Spirit works through and with your word to form these truths in our hearts, and we pray that it may be so. So much so that when we sing the hymns and the songs, our hearts are swelled with the truth about you and your goodness to us and the glories of being your people. So please, Lord, deal with us, all of us, we pray. And we thank you that these are truths that can be known by little children and truths that exceed the understanding of learned professors, all at the same time. How wonderful you are in all your being and all your ways. And we bless you, Father, for your Son. And we ask for grace that we may ever honor you, the one eternal God, whom heaven and earth adore. For it has always been so. Please, hear our cry. Deal bountifully with us, we ask. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Amen.